Connie Martinson talks books. Her name was Isabel Van Cleek Lyon. She was, well, nobody knew of her years later, but she was the other woman. She was Mark Twain's other woman, and this is the hidden story of his final years, written by my guest, Laura Scandera Twomley. And the book is published by Knopf. Welcome, Laura.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
Well, what a soap opera, in a way, of Mark Twain's final years.
Mm-hmm. It does have the elements of soap opera.
Well, Isabel is hired first by his wife, Olivia.
Mm-hmm.
And she becomes part, she doesn't live in.
No.
Olivia made sure she lived away, which was fine. Her mother was there with Isabel. She goes to Italy with them, and while they're in Italy, Olivia dies.
Mm-hmm. Yes, after a long and very difficult illness, she finally passes away in 1904, and the family falls apart.
Yeah. Now, Isabel had come from what we'd call a nouveau poor.
Yes.
The family had had, you know, financial sort of well-being at one point, but by this time, she was a woman who hadn't married.
Mm-hmm.
She knew enough to be sort of a secretary and amanuensis for somebody, mm-hmm. but she was still below the salt.
This is true. She had a very hard life and a disappointing life. She thought that she was going to make her debut. Her father speculated in real estate, passed away, then her uncle died, and her brother committed suicide. And she found herself really faced with a life of service. And she knew that this was a very different kind of existence than what she had wanted for herself.
Why do we not know about her?
Well, there are a lot of reasons why. Mark Twain was determined that we would never know about her, and to that end, he wrote a 429-page blackmail document that he threatened and his daughter threatened to have published if Isabel ever told anyone, first, that she even knew Mark Twain, or for them, most importantly, that she knew any of the family's secrets.
Now, you had already written a book about Mark Twain and his women.
Mm-hmm.
When did you discover Isabel, and what made you feel there's more to this than the public knows?
This was in the early 90s, and I was finishing my first book, Mark Twain and the Company of Women, where I really focused on the impact that Olivia had upon him, as well as the various educators and reformers and physicians that she knew. And I ran across Isabel's things when I was working at the Mark Twain Project in Berkeley. And I knew that there was a story here. However, I really didn't have time to look into mm-hmm. it very much because my subject was somewhat different.
But where did you find the letters? Her journal that she kept. And she did. Every day was a journal. And she ended up calling him, what, Santissima. She called the girls a different name. And so, in a way, you had to decipher her journal.
This is true. She had actually willed her papers to the Mark Twain archive with the condition that Clara, Twain's only surviving direct descendant, never know about the gift. It had to be kept a secret from Clara because she knew that Clara would probably try and destroy all of her papers. Mm-hmm. And nothing really had been done with it over the years.
Yeah.
There was only one previous Twain scholar that referenced her, mm-hmm. and that was years ago in 1971. And when I asked to see her papers, they were carried out in a plain cardboard box. No indexing or archiving had ever been done, and they were just kind of piled in there.
You must have felt like discovering gold when you got that box.
I was astonished at what I found. First, she has an extraordinary record of the last years of Twain's life. Mm-hmm. Because of her, we knew what he was eating, who he was seeing, what he was reading, how he was feeling. And what was also striking to me was included in the box, there was a bundle of papers, letters that Twain scholars from a previous generation had written, saying that her papers really were of no value. And I just really couldn't make sense out of this.
Yeah. Well, Olivia dies, and there's even a picture of her that her daughter Jean took of her in Italy. Twain is beside himself because he adored Olivia. But he needs someone to come in and help. And Clara is busy being a singer, a musician. Jean is psychotic, or she's bipolar. And she is in and out of sanitariums. So in a way, Twain was dependent on Isabel.
He was. He needed someone to take Olivia's place. And Isabel was already known and well-liked by everyone in the household. Clara really couldn't stand being in her father's presence, and she was definitely the rebel, and she led a bohemian lifestyle, one that Twain didn't really approve of. Jean was very, very ill. She suffered from epilepsy and depression, and Twain really wanted Isabel, in effect, to step in as her nurse. Yeah. And there were times when Jean would have upwards of a dozen convulsions and seizures a day. And so this was a lot for Isabel to take on. However, she didn't have a lot of other choices, yeah, and the opportunity to be so close to a global celebrity was certainly attractive, yeah, to her.
And she, this is the difference. Twain has her move into the house.
That's a big difference, and
yes,
one that the daughters did not like.
Clara would come back and say, how dare you tell the cook what to do? I'm the one who's going to tell it. And then everybody would be in great conflict because Clara wouldn't stay long, but she would create this turmoil when she was there.
She liked to try and create the illusion that she, yeah, was the mistress of the house, but she truly wasn't that interested in being in charge. But she also was on the defensive, yeah, because she was concerned that Isabel was gaining too much power and that her father relied upon her too much.
Well, she now comes in and they're building a big house outside of New York City, and they have the names for the place, and Isabel becomes involved and she furnishes it.
She did everything. She was, yeah, the general contractor. She built Twain a pleasure palace, and the entire home was intended to delight him. Every room that he entered, she had chosen all the decorations just for him, and he adored it. He, yeah, thought this was just a fantasy come real.
And he did not pay her very well, but he did not scrimp on himself. This is Mark Twain in his white cashmere cape and clothes.
He owned 24 of those suits at the time of his death, and in today's dollars, they cost nearly $2,000 each.
Really?
Hand-tailored.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And he did not pay Isabel that much.
$50 a month, 24/7.
And then once in a while, he would give her a check to buy a dress.
Yes, mainly because he wanted her to be dressed in an attractive and colorful fashion so she could set off what he was wearing better.
Yeah. But he takes her to Bermuda. Mm-hmm. In between, they would have not a falling out, but he would make her go back to below the salt instead of being his companion. The example of that was his 70th birthday.